about what strength and style means and discuss topics about body image, gender stereotypes, sources of positivity, unapologetic self-expression, and individuality. So I think it's more fun to kind of let everyone introduce themselves so they can just talk a little bit about what they do for a living and what's important to them in a personal way. So, Erin, you want to start?
Oh, wow. Hi.
So,
my name is Erin. I have my own brand called Made Me. It's a small women's line, and I also work at Spain. I work at Spain for 12 years.
Hey guys, my name is Kitty Cash, and I'm a DJ, producer, model from Brooklyn, New York. I hope you guys are feeling good today.
Hi guys, my name is Alex Tangway, and I am the global brand director at Spotify. So I'm representing corporate America.
Okay, amazing. So we can just get into it. So I'm just going to ask you guys questions and you can sort of give me a response. And if anyone wants to jump in with something to add, please feel free. So first off, Erin, I'll just ask you, what does strength and style mean to you? And what is the significance of your expression?
You can
start with the strength and style.
We were just talking earlier, and I just think it's pain in yourself. I really feel that way. I'm wearing a suit with eyeballs all over it, so I think it's just really important to be yourself, and that's strength and style.
Well, what is the significance of creative expression? So, like, do you think that there's power in how we creatively express ourselves?
Oh, of course. Yeah, of course. And, like, fashion is probably the main, you know, kind of way you can do that without really saying anything. You know, you don't have to be an artist to express yourself what you're wearing. So totally feel that way. Yeah, totally agree.
Okay, Myla. Social media is obviously a super powerful communication tool and can be a great way to bring people together, but it also can do a number like on our self-worth and our confidence. So how do you have any tips for keeping up with technology and not letting it
This is really hard. I think I have very serious issues with social media. I can only handle one. I only do Instagram, and I can barely handle that, to be honest. It's so mentally taxing, and I think I have a public job. You know, I'm like in the public sphere. I have thousands of people that I don't know following me. Not that many thousands, but enough to feel like, you know, you have an audience of strangers that are listening to what you say and judging you all the time. And I find it really challenging to balance, like, this virtual identity that I have with who I actually am, because, you know, I really desire to be a truthful person. You know, a lot of my brand identity is, you know, like accepting who you are, loving your body, etc. And, you know, there are just so many times that I wake up and I'm like, I feel like shit, you know, like I look like shit, or look at this beautiful girl, and she has a million followers, and this and that. You know, it's just, it is like so draining. And I have struggled so much with how to manage it. I think like the basics would be unfollow people that make you feel bad.
That's really
good. Like, it is so hard to do that, though. And sometimes, you know, you do that, like, hate follow, where you're just, like, following somebody because you want to see what they're up to because you are really jealous and you actually hate them. But it makes you feel so much better when you just stop looking. You know, like, don't read comments on posts that you know people are going to write mean things. Like, if I put up a political post, generally I just stop reading the comments because, you know, I don't want to read about how people tell me that women should get back in the kitchen or, you know, that I'm killing babies by, like, supporting Planned Parenthood. And it's not healthy, you know, so it's like you have to kind of take those steps to maintain your mental health. Put yourself on an Instagram diet. I've done that before. Put your phone in the other room.
How does one exactly do an Instagram diet?
I'll sign out for the whole day, and if I sign back in, then I have to put money in my savings account. Saving for a
I was just gonna say, I got to know sometimes today, I saw some pictures of you, you was really happy on Instagram, I hope you're happy in real life, and I was like, okay, no, I actually am, and I think it's like a good reminder, though, that people just fake on social media, you remind yourself that, like, this is not real, like, you're not happy all the time, you're not doing this all the time, but I think it's a good reminder, like, it's okay to not be okay.
You also can never win in terms of that, because you can post 100 million photos of yourself happy as hell and like, oh, I'm on vacation, my life is amazing. And then everyone's like, okay, well, you know, she's kind of fake. But then if you post a photo of yourself when you're very upset or you're sick, then everyone wants to call you a snowflake and tell you that like you're complaining, but your life is amazing and you don't deserve to complain. So it's like, I think also just accepting that you can't win ever in those situations is like helpful.
I think one tip that I have as well is like understanding that we all should just really, really cherish a certain level of privacy, and everything doesn't have to be online, because if you want something, you know, if you're not looking for constructive, let's just say it's constructive criticism or someone's unwarranted opinion, it's like you also didn't really have to post it, right? And for me, you know, maybe it's my family time with my mom and my sisters, or maybe it's like I'm on a date and I'm not posting that because you actually don't need to know. And I think that sometimes we feel like you have to like content, hashtag, like content creator, whatever. But sometimes you just don't. And I think that just allows you to live in the moment and just be present, because a lot of times we just aren't present because we're on our phones and always like doing that quick update. Like, you know, when you're at dinner and you wait for the other person to like turn around and refresh really quick. Sometimes it's okay like not to refresh and just enjoy the time that you're sharing with someone else.
While you're kind of there, why don't we move on to the next question, which is, so one of the things that I really, really love about the heritage of Vans as a brand is that it's all about inclusivity and like personal expression. So how does, for example, a brand like Vans express, enable you to express your creativity?
I think that when you work with the brand, it's very, very important for them to allow you to be you. And you don't want to feel like you are compromising who you are as an artist or a talent or a person to make them happy. And when I do talk to a lot of my friends about, you know, getting to partner with a brand because you're trying to push a project, you're like, yeah, but they want their logo and everything, and they want, you know, I don't know, they just want you to do things that it's not truly organic to you as a person. And I think, you know, I've done a few events with Vans, and it's always really cool because, you know, someone like Lil Sims, who's performing today, is a girl that I kind of discovered a minute ago, and she was on my first mixtape, Love for Free, which kind of like was my entry like into the world as an artist, as Kitty Cash. So I just think things like that, where you find a true organic type of synergy, is when working with the brand is great, and it allows you to be yourself, which you express yourself and express your creativity in a real way.
So let's talk about balancing being your authentic self while also sort of complying with societal norms or not complying.
I mean, societal norms or work norms?
Well, the follow-up is going to be like, how do you navigate your personal expression in the workplace, which is sort of related and unrelated, but yeah,
we're all lucky that we live in a city like New York, where the societal norms are a lot wider, I think, than they are in a lot of other places. So I don't think it's as much of a concern to think about how you're sort of fitting in New York City, and that's probably really unique to us as New Yorkers. But for me, I mean, I think the reason why this question sort of resonated is I've kind of grown up in a corporate track from a career perspective. I was at Nike for almost 4 years, and before that I was at some ad agencies, and I'm at Spotify now, and it is, I'm lucky in that I've always been in a creative leaning position, but inside of a corporate environment, right? So, and for me, it's always one of those things where like, you have to come out the bat and make sure that you are being authentic to who you are as an individual, but not loud in that, right? And so once you get to a place where you've earned the respect from folks around you for why you were brought in to do the job, then you let your hair down, sort of like figuratively and literally. And then people love you even more for that, right? So it's always about like making sure that you're in the work environment and you're putting yourself and your skills at first, and then letting everyone know who you are as an individual second. And I think that has been sort of like the measure of success and how I've been able to kind of like carve out my leaning to the past to a place where now, where I am as a global sort of director type of role, people love that I'm fucking weird, right? Like, and it's accepted because I've like gotten to that point before I like showed them how weird I am.
Yeah, so do you feel like you can actually let your hair down fully?
For sure. For sure, but like, I've been at Spotify for 3 years, so the first year that I was there, I didn't do that. The first year that I was there, I wore, the right things, and I kind of like blended in a little bit more until people got to know me as an individual on a one-on-one basis, and then all of a sudden, like, you have your mini win at work, or you have your campaign that kills it, and people start to pay attention to you, and you're like, okay, this is really who I am. So it's a bit of a slow roll, and that's just kind of how you play it safe in the corporate world, and that's what's worked for me. I think there are people that come out the gate at work and show the world who they are and are equally successful for that. It just depends on what your sort of level of comfortability is with that, and for me, like, that's worked for me as a woman in a corporate environment.
Totally, I think a lot of people can relate to that. Okay, cool. So Molly, let's talk a little bit about career path. And basically, I think a lot of us have an idea of our career path before we get started and, have a plan basically in our minds. But then I think that sometimes things come up and obviously things don't go necessarily always as planned. So can you share some unexpected surprises that have happened along your career path, whether they're good or bad or a good, story?
Yeah, I never really knew, I'm a photographer and a writer, and that was not ever something that I wanted to be. Both my parents are self-employed, and I just grew up thinking that, I too was going to be self-employed, and didn't really know what that was going to look like. I moved across the country when I was 18 by myself, and started, acting, and then after a year stopped doing that, and eventually went to college for botany, and, was really into botany and research, and super dorky science stuff, and loved that, and then dropped out of college, and now I'm a photographer, and it's great. And my dad just constantly reminded me that you can be as many things as you want to be. There's so much time in your life. I had a meeting today, totally out of the blue, with Rolling Stone magazine. They just DM'd me yesterday. I never in my life thought that that was something I was working towards or wanted to happen. It's crazy, because I'm like, what? But I want to work at the grocery store, in a small town. I'm kind of prepared for my life, as I'm living it and being true to myself, to lead me where it's going to lead me. There's, I don't have a 5-year plan for what I'm doing or a 10-year plan, other than every day I want to wake up and know that what I'm doing is something that feels good and makes me stoked. That's what put me in college for botany. I was like, fuck man, I'm so lost. My boyfriend, he knows exactly what he wants to do. And so how am I gonna figure that out? Well, in what environment am I happy? And I thought, oh, well, I'm happy outside. I'm happy when I'm getting dirty. And so that's what put me in college for that. And so I don't know, for anyone who doesn't really know what they're up to or why they're doing what they're doing, just try to build a relationship with your intuition.
intuition and your integrity.
Did you? That's amazing. I think that that's something that we can all work harder on.
I feel like you should answer this question.
Well, I wanted to just go into and say, did you ever feel any tension between what you wanted to do and what you felt like you should do?
Yeah.
Or was it always clear to you from a young age that you, like, this is what makes me happy?
I've never known, you know, like, that's why, like, when I do changes, like, I'm interested in a lot of stuff. Like, I play instruments, but I'm not in a band, you know, I don't perform in front of people, and I don't really publish a lot of the stuff that I write, or, like, crafts that I make, or whatever, you know, so it's kind of just a constant, like, quest for trying to wake up and feel happy, you know, and, like, I was thinking when we were talking about social media, like, I'm not really somebody who's, like, I'm happy and look how great my life is. I'm a pretty honest person in a way that, like, maybe makes some people uncomfortable, but, like, you know, I, like, look at this beautiful mountain, like, I fell down that shit, you know, or, like, I was, like, crying here on this hike today, like, that's what got me out of bed to, like, go do something different, and so, like, for me, yeah, I don't really know, like, what that path is, and haven't really ever known, but, like, I want to figure it out, you know, maybe one day I'll find it, I don't know, maybe one day I'll land in a spot where I'm like, oh, not only do I want to do this, but I'm killing it. I guess I'm kind of in that spot now.
Yeah. Well, and it seems like you've kind of reached the place where you're, like, accepting that you don't know, and kind of, it's a moving target, so you just are continually having a conversation with yourself, like,
yeah.
Understand and what's the target.
And I'll, like, try to stretch what I'm doing, too, like, I'll do, you know, I don't do a lot of advertising, but I'll, like, do something and see how I felt shooting that and see what I thought about the work that came from it. Or, like, you know, like, going to this meeting today, like, that's not where I saw myself going, but, like, maybe I'll try it and maybe I'll love it, or maybe I won't, and that'll help, like, help me go into a different path. So, just try and fit.
Amazing, thank you. Lindsay, so let's talk about the workplace again. And also, I'm going to sort of say, or the industry that you work on, because not everyone obviously works in a workplace, like, Molly, for example, is a freelance photographer. So, how do you navigate gender stereotypes in the workplace, double standards, and the pay gap, and any other sort of issues in the workplace that you feel like you feel passionately about, or that is something that you have tension in the office? How do you navigate that?
Honestly, it's really interesting for me personally, because as I've gotten older, I've realized that I just have to be as vocal as possible, and when I started out in fashion, I very much, like, tiptoed around my bosses or people that I worked with, and just kind of, I think, let a lot of things slide. And I cannot tell you how many times people said, like, you know, the most horrible things about being a woman or being a Black woman or wearing my hair natural or whatever it was. And I think now when I think about those things, I'm like, girl, you should have cussed her out. Like, you shouldn't let that happen. But it's growth. I think now I want to educate people, and I do that at my job still. If somebody's like, oh, like, I didn't know you could really do that, or I don't know if, like, you really have the bandwidth to do this, kindly, sir, check yourself. I can do this, and here's why. But I think, like, also with the pay, I think it's really interesting because I talk a lot with a lot of young Black girls who come to me and say, hey, I want to be in fashion. How do you do it, et cetera? And if you're starting out, you're not going to make a lot of money. And I always tell them, like, look, you need to make it clear to whoever you work for, like, I can't survive off of $9 an hour. I need to be making this much money. I am happy to do overtime. I'm happy to bust my butt and, like, be your personal slave, but I need to be making money, that kind of thing. And I think you have to be honest. Like, when I started my job at New York Magazine, I told my boss, like, I don't have a trust fund, so you're gonna have to actually pay me. Like, you're not going to pay me what you assume I will be living off of. You're actually gonna have to pay me. And I think now that I'm older, I can have that confidence, but I wish that I would have when I was younger. I feel like I would probably not dislike so many people that I came across if I had just told them in the first place. But yeah, I mean, I think it's hard when you're in that situation, but I think you have to be as vocal and as honest as you can.
I think practicing, learning how to talk about money is really important for everyone, but I think especially for women, because I don't know, I grew up in a family where we didn't really talk about money ever, you know, like my dad dad would say, you get your paycheck, put 10% in the bank, but that was it. And no one ever taught me how much I was supposed to be making, or like how to do a budget, or how to pay my taxes. And I think like having those kind of conversations, learning about that kind of stuff is really important. I think the Times published something recently that had a bunch of books about each, like maybe 5 books about investing, and like the dummy's guide to how to buy a house eventually, stuff like that. Like, I think it's really important that you take the time to actually learn that stuff and like practice with your friends talking about money. You don't have to ask a friend how much money you make, but you know, you need to be able to know how to ask for it.
I was gonna say, Molly, do you wanna speak to like negotiating as a freelancer?
It's hard. We live in a day and age when the word content is like thrown around everywhere, and we're all like expected to do what we do for free or for trade. And as a freelancer, that's really hard. Like most of the work opportunities I get are people that like once I respond like asking what the budget is, like there's no response, or like they expect my landlord accepts like, you know, like a pair of pants, you know, as rent, which she just doesn't, you know. I've tried. So like knowing your worth is like whether you're a musician or an artist or a writer, and like, and this is not just for freelancers too, but like in the workplace, like I'm not gonna work for like less than $15 an hour. Like I want a living wage. Or for me, like if you want me to like use what I've built, what, like my social channel, for example, like if you want me to use what I've built off my work to like elevate your brand or steer in a certain direction, then like I want to be paid for like what I'm going to be doing for you, because in, like at the end of the day, like you're not the client, you know, like you're like the person that's steering them, you're the creative person. So as a freelancer, like it's been a struggle because you have to constantly advocate for yourself in a way that maybe you don't have to in a corporate setting, when there's certain people that like it's their job to do that for you. But also like I haven't always been a freelancer, and so like constantly asking for a living wage has been a challenge. But I just don't work for free, you know, like it's just not how it works in the real world.
No, I just think you know, I have a lot of conversations around this. Just ask for what you deserve, and don't be afraid to ask for what you deserve.
But how do you know what you deserve? How do you get to the place where you know?
You deserve more than you think you deserve.
Yeah.
And that was a huge reality check for me. Like I said, I've been at Spotify for 3 years. I hired a man with several years less experience than me, who works on my team, and when he asked me for what his salary was, it was significantly more than what mine was. And that was an eye-opener to me. I was like, oh shit, I'm not getting paid, but I should get paid, you know? And if I'm gonna hire him, then I'm getting a paycheck right now, because I'm not gonna have someone working for me that makes more money than me, right? And I think the reality, the fact is, for some reason, as women, we're really shy about asking for what we deserve. Ask for it. No one's ever gonna say you're not gonna get the, or like no one's ever gonna walk away from offering you the job because the money's not there. They're either gonna say, we can't give you that, but we can give you X. But they're not gonna walk away or change their mind. And I say this to all of the young women that I mentor all the time, like, ask for it, the worst you're gonna get is a no, and then you go back and you have another decision to make, do you wanna do this kind of money? But it's something that, you know, I work in technology, there are significantly more men, significantly more white men at Spotify than there are anything else, and I use that, you know, I use that, I hire strictly women, with the exception of this one guy I was talking about, and I, you know, and I honestly like fight for their salary, and it's something like you have to empower those around you. And when you get to a point where you're in a leadership role, like there are plenty of white dudes out there that only hire white dudes, so like I'm cool with just hiring chicks, and I'm open about it, and I tell everyone on Spotify about it, you know, what it is.
Say that again.
Is anyone looking for a job at Spotify? So I kind of just wanted to touch base on what you said, like how do you know your worth?
Yeah.
So some of you may know, some of you may not, but I did work in the corporate space for my last job for like 4 years, and I had a marketing and communications for North America. And it was really wild because I was the type of person that I was like, okay, they are acting like they don't want to pay me, So I like went through, I was being sneaky. Sometimes you have to be sneaky, number one. And I went through like everything that my old boss did, and like I called her because we got cool. And she basically told me like, these were the things that I contributed. And what I learned working in corporate was like, if you do something that you know is valuable, and however you can quantify that, you mark that down.
Yep.
And then you keep the receipts, you know, as you say, like keep the receipts, keep the emails, you know, let them know like this is the value of what I did. And then when you go to your manager, whoever, you know, your contact is, you let them know like, this is what I brought to the table, and this is what it's worth. You know, in my field, it was like, this is the media value, this is the amount of impressions, and then you're like, you see, I know you never had these numbers before, so I think you need to increase my pay. And on the flip side, as an artist, it's so crazy because you're like, I know I should be getting paid way more. And I think before I got my booking agent, you know, I have a booking agent now, so it was okay, but I had like three emails. I was like, look, I was my manager, my assistant, and my publicist answering all these emails. Like, I'm sorry, she isn't available unless you have that. But it's like, you have to do it because I feel like just me as an artist responding to people, it's like, come on, girl, you know you're the homie, or, you know, everybody gets you with that, especially when you're friends with everybody. You're like, but I still have to eat and pay my rent. So I would just say, like, if you don't have representation, you probably have a friend that's like looking to get into the industry, or you have like, you know, a family member or someone that can speak on your behalf, because when you speak on your behalf, it gets tricky. Yeah. But if you have someone else who's being very like blunt, like, hey, this is her rate, and you say no, sometimes you realize that saying no gets you what you actually wanted in the first place. And that's something that I've learned a lot with.
Yeah. Or someone else.
Okay, so since we're talking about workplace and outside of workplace when you're freelance, let's just go through, because I feel like everyone probably can relate to this, but describe a tough day and like how you work through a hard day at work, and like how you rise above a tough situation. And it can be really anything, but I, you know, I don't know. I know it's kind of a thinker, but Lynn, do you have to start?
You start.
So
you
can take that.
I'm mostly doing laundry or swimsuit. That's just my beat. And
Lingerie.
Sometimes you end up in weird situations with dudes, and they think it's okay to say inappropriate stuff to you when you're standing there on a job in your underwear, or they find excuses to touch you, or like rub up on you, or ask you to come over after work, you know, just all kinds of shit. And for a long time, I thought that you just have to kind of laugh it off, and that's just what you do, because what if they don't ever book you again, you know, or who knows, you know, what if you get in trouble with your agency? And as I got older, I started to realize how good it really feels to kind of just go like, actually back the fuck up. You know, maybe I'm not really saying fuck, but you know, it's okay to not laugh that stuff off. And it, you know, I think it's similar but different to what you're talking about, that you know, you deserve to be respected, and especially in your workplace and by your colleagues. You know, there's a reason that you're there, and you do a good job, and that's why you're paid to do what you do. And that means that you also deserve respect. So I think there's nothing wrong with saying like, would you be saying that to me if I were a man? You know, things like that. And maybe that person thinks that you're a bitch, but like, do you really care what they think? Because they're the person that said that to you.
Totally.
I would say one of my toughest days at work was last year. One of the shoots I was working on was with Issa Rae. And just my whole reason and purpose for being in fashion is to really tell the stories of women that I think are doing really amazing things that fashion just does not want to give that credit to. And I was really, that day I was gonna lose my mind because every designer that I wanted to shoot, I, you know, called in all these favors and designers kept being like, no, like she's not chic enough, or like, no, like we really can't help you with this. Like she's not, you know, the size that we really want to put our girls in. And I was, I literally got 11 no's in a row and I like walked out of work because I just couldn't take it anymore because I know that if it would have been somebody who is just whatever skinny blonde, it would have just been, yeah, like you can pick this up at two, like whatever. But I think like that was a really good day for me because when I think about it now, I know that I had to continue to persevere and I called in all those friends in a roundabout way. Basically, I have a couple friends who work at like Barney's or other places, and I was like, hey, so this brand will let me pull from them, but can I pull this from you? And I still got those brands. And it was funny because when those brands saw her in the clothes, they were like, oh my god, wait, she actually does look really good.
Yeah,
she's
amazing. But like, why would you still want to pull from them?
Well, because then my thinking for that is, okay, so I still think that she deserves to be in campaigns. I think that she deserves to be in those brands. I think she deserves to be in Cartier and all that shit. Like, I think that, I don't want to put her
super black.
Like, yeah, no, it is, but like, I'm not going to put her in a brand that I feel like isn't going to continue to elevate her. And I feel like it's me proving them wrong and showing that they need to change what they think about women of color and what they think about women of color.
Your girl Michelle will give you man for any shoe you have.
Look at one. Honestly, I can't get it. But I can get back to you on that. I can look at the picture.
Lindsay, in the situation now, so that was one experience.
Yes.
So since then, when people say no, do you ever push them back? Do you ever have a conversation with them? Like, this is important. This is something that you guys should be supporting. Do you take the time to educate people, or you just kind of let them be ignorant?
I'm petty, so honestly, I'm just like, okay, I'm gonna take a mental note of this, and when you need something from me later, I'm gonna act like you don't exist, don't ask me. And it comes around every single time, where they're like, oh wait, well, Lindsay, you just did this really cool story, like, I got an email from Real Good, you said no exactly for that shoot. She's like, hey, I heard you're working on something with this really big model that's about to be facing this brand, like, what's going on? Delete? Like, nothing's going on.
So do you... You don't respond. So you don't remind them of what they did in the past. So it's possible that they don't even remember.
I feel like sometimes they don't even remember. But if I see like that PR person or something, and they ask, like, oh, like, whatever happened with that? You never responded. Then I'll tell them, like, hey, you know, it was really shady. And I did actually have a conversation with a PR person about that because I felt like, no shade to her, but I felt like Lena Dunham was getting a lot of press around that time because of girls. But Issa Rae, who's also writing her own show, and on that same level, wasn't getting the same treatment. And so I did explain to her, like, look, you know, you'll make custom stuff for Mia Dunham, but you want to act like Issa Rae doesn't exist, and that's not cool. But that was one time. I mean, I try not to go off too much.
Molly, do you want to talk about a hard day at work?
Yeah, well, I check people constantly. I'm like, I mean, I try to like stop myself from damaging relationships, but my highest paying client and my biggest job that I would have ever done that never came out for no real good reason, like these people constantly praising me, saying they loved it, saying they love everything I want to do, they want to work with me all the time. But then the shoot or the editorial keeps getting pushed. Next issue, next issue. It's
why do they do that? Why do they say they love it? And then
no idea.
You're the magazine mom.
I don't know.
I don't know.
I know.
Yeah, I have no idea.
It lags a lot.
Yeah. But so, you know, like this magazine had done, it did this to me and then a couple of other things where I just felt like I wasn't really feeling the honesty with them. And I also assisted, like previously before I was shooting for them, I assisted people who shot for them, who, this is like a magazine that shoots a lot of women, and I've seen like women disrespected by the male photographers that were working for this magazine. And then like every girl that I try to avoid shooting like white girls. I'm white, but I like to avoid that. And every girl that I pitched them, like they weren't interested in, but then would throw back like some like social media like girl that didn't work for what she has to me, they'll get me to shoot them. And anyway, this brand I just kept having these issues with, and one day like wrote them an email that was like, I'm not interested in like continuing this relationship with you because you like primarily highlight photographers who like are misogynist and sexually aggressive to women. You over and over and over again put like skinny white girls who like don't have average bodies in your magazine, and then also give me this runaround over and over and over again praising me, and like yet all your photographers are male, and like I'm just not really wanting to have that kind of relationship with media. And I got an email back from them that was like, we get it and we still want to work with you. I never work with them again, so I'm like trying to get that back. But I felt really good about it, and that was a long time ago. And I think that like for me, like every time I've stood up for myself in that way, whether it's with this magazine or with others, because that's not the first time that I've done something like that, just kind of spoken up about how I feel, I've felt good about it. And like, yeah, maybe lost that client, but it also pushes me closer to like knowing what I do want to do in the prints or magazines or artists that I do want to work with. And also like, don't buy that shit, you know, like don't work with designers that like, I mean, you know, everybody make their own judgment with like the support, like we gotta do stuff, but trying to support less the things that work against me, and sometimes that involves like a really bad day for me to figure that out.
Erin, did you want to talk about it?
Well, listening to you guys, I feel really lucky. So, I own my own company, and I just want to touch back on the paying thing. So, I make it a point that I've never once in my life ever asked someone to do something for free. So, I think that's a point to pay everybody. And then, I also partner with Cream, which you would think would be like the most like dude-centric company on planet Earth. And it probably sounds like a nightmare for like a lesbian woman like me to work there, but it's great, and it couldn't be better. I have awesome new network, and I work in a really creative environment where I feel really like cherished, and we all listen to each other, and we all have creative input on what happens, and the owner of Supreme is like probably one of the coolest people on the planet, so. I feel lucky, guys. I don't know what I did right, but something. Yeah, so cool.
No bad days.
I mean, of course, I have bad days. They're just more based around like workload. You know, like I'm busy. I have my own company, and I
could talk about that. Like as a woman, like the obligation to multitask and like the higher expectations for managing workload.
I don't know if that is different for women or men. I do think women are better at it. I do get frustrated because I do work with a lot of men, and I don't think they're as good at that as women tend to be, but that's a generalization.
But do you think that causes women to take on more because they're good at it? That's what I'm saying.
Women do.
Multitasking.
Yeah, women do tend to take on more. Yeah. I don't know if that's like a social, I don't know if that's a social thing. I don't know what that is. But I do think we're a little bit better at it. I mean, there are some guys that come across in my career that are fucking great at it. You know, like the owner is great, the head designer that I work with at Supreme is great. But yeah, I'm running my own company and working a full-time gig and managing 30 people at work, you know, so I'm busy. And I sometimes leave there and I feel like, has anyone been to like a fair and like the Gravitron, you know, that thing where you like stuff together? Where it spins around. Like sometimes I'd be there and I feel crazy because I just work so hard, you know, and I'm probably like not the nicest person to be with at home, but sometimes. But yeah, I don't really face all these kind of things because I think you guys work in a little bit more corporate environments, and then YouTube freelancers, I know a little bit about that because my wife is also a freelancer, so I hear a lot of that stuff. But I really happen to work for this like great organic company that's like was a mom and pop shop, and now we have hundreds of employees all over the world who are doing great things, you know. So I feel very lucky that way.
I just want to say one more thing in terms of what Molly was saying about speaking out for yourself. I've never regretted like pushing back against someone or telling them that the way that they're treating me is inappropriate, or like saying that I wasn't going to tolerate like disrespectful behavior. I've never regretted that. The only situations that I do regret are the times when I haven't said or done that. So do it.
Well, I'm just going to add one more thing. I do have to say that I've had to very much assert myself in that environment with all those guys. Like, when I first got the job there, I was the only girl that had ever worked there, you know? And so now, I think there's 10 women that work under me that I've hired there. And of course, like, in the beginning, when I worked at Supreme, like, they were like, you don't know shit about skate, or like, what do you know about hip hop and all that kind of stuff? And, you know, you kind of just like take it on the chin and you learn more and you keep it moving. And I do have to say one other thing about getting paid and speaking up about how much you feel like you should get paid. I only feel like you should do that if your work reflects that. Because I do feel like there's this thing.
Good call.
Where sometimes people do ask for things and you kind of like tweak your head a bit, because I've been doing this for 15 years and I know when somebody is good at what they do and they have experience. And I do think you can't say enough about hard work, you know, guy, girl, whoever, you know.
Can you say that again for the people in the back?
They're being quiet.
No, I just need the idea that it's going to work.
You're so funny.
Like, he's on the Rachel Bundy.
It's a marathon, not a race.
Yeah.
And it's all about the journey, and you talked a lot about that too, but like from a career path perspective, I never planned on being here. I never thought I'd be 34 years old, running the global brand of Spotify, living the life that I'm living at all. It wasn't what I planned, and I just took the opportunities that fell in front of me, and I stumbled a lot, and I learned a lot, and I had a lot of shitty jobs that I hated, and I got fired, and I quit, and all of that, but you figure out where you're comfortable, you figure out what you want to do from the things you don't want to do, and you'll land somewhere, and then you know what? The next chapter might happen in a year that's completely different.
Oh, me again. Okay. I totally agree with what you said, and I just wanted to add that don't forget people who helped you along the way. So I did my first shoe with bands in 2010, and the party I had for that shoe was the opening party for this space. And so when these guys, it was the first event that ever happened in this space. So when these guys asked me to come talk on the panel, although I hate talking on panels, I said, of course I would do that. So, and we're working on our second shoe together that's coming out later this year. So they didn't forget about me, and I didn't forget about them. Anyone else have advice? No.
I would tell myself two things. One would be just do it. I think a lot of times we sit down, we tell our friends our ideas. Huh? Wrong brand. Should I rephrase that? No, but you know, like when you say you're gonna do something, actually commit to it and see it through. Better?
Yeah.
And I say that because I think a lot of the times you have like endless ideas, and it's like, I want to do this and I want to do that. And I think what you need to do, and what I've been telling myself, is just like make a list, big or small, and just start checking things off, because you don't want to get caught up in constantly coming up with ideas but never completing an idea and never actually seeing that growth and that progress. And secondly, I would say, it's so easy to be afraid to try something new. And I say that because DJing literally fell into my lap, you know what I mean? It was like, I was holding on my homegirl, who was like a singer rapper at the time, and she was just figuring out, and I was like, oh, why not just try it? And who would have thought I would have literally changed my entire career path / life and be doing this full time? So I think if you're in a position where, you know, maybe you are working a full-time job and trying to make your hobby bigger, the same way like Erin, like, you know, you're doing, I think it's super tight that she's an example of someone that can work a full-time job but also build a brand that so many people love.
I'm never allowed to leave that company, that's why. Oh. I'm trapped.
No,
For me, I think I was like, oh, but what if I don't get enough gigs, or what if I don't actually grow, or what if, and it was a whole bunch of what ifs, until finally it was like, okay, if you don't quit now, you're never going to quit, you're going to be stuck here, and you're going to be pissed off and happy. So it's better to kind of just take that leap and put 200% into whatever you want to do, than kind of like stick your foot in it and like bring it back and be afraid, instead of just, you know, just going for it.
So many people like write stuff on Instagram like, oh, I really want to do this, or like on Twitter like, oh man, like I wish I could really do this. And I feel like in our society we do so much talking, and I would just love like all the people that actually want to do things to actually do them and follow through. And when I meet a lot of young girls who want to be in fashion, they're like, how did you do this? I'm like, you have to do the work. You can't just like say you want a style, or you want to, you know, get in with this brand or things like that, you have to do work. And I would also, my personal motto that I guess advice that I give myself every day is to be what I needed when I was younger. And that's actually something that my mother told me. But I think that that resonates with me every single day, because it has given me purpose and a reason for doing what I'm doing. And an actual feeling like, okay, this is what I need to see diversity, I need to see inclusivity, and like, this is what I'm putting in this world.
Just to continue that kind of thing, like, someone recently was talking to me about instant gratification. Like, I can tell all of you, like, oh, I'm putting out a book, it's gonna be this and this, and like, you all react to it right now in this moment, you make me feel good about this project. I don't ever actually have to put out that book. And I just recently put out my first zine. I've been a photographer for a pretty long time at this point, many years. I just put out my first thing of like more than one photo at a time. And that took forever. There was so much pressure around it. And once I heard this advice from a friend, like not to just go for that instant gratification, it really helped me like make tactile objects with the things that I was doing, or to create a project that like you've been talking about or you've been wanting to do and be about it. And then for me, for my younger self, it's probably Destino America for me based on what I've already said so far, but I wish I had stayed more focused. I mean, I'm 28, I had a screen name starting in like late elementary school, middle school, and got really distracted. I was somebody who was like super into school and my dad was really strict, but then just kind of fell off course, and that was fine, I guess, but like I always think back to like what kind of person I might have been if I had followed through on more things when I was younger, even if I didn't want to. But who knows, you know, like I'm not in a bad place right now, but staying focused is something that like I still have to try to put into myself. When I look around, whether it's on social media or in real life, thinking like, how did that person get that? Like, why don't I have that? You know, it's like, well, maybe they put in more hours throughout their day. Maybe they stayed more actively engaged in the things that they care about. Even if it just feels like a creative hobby throughout the day, maybe kind of like painting, like put some hours in and like see where that takes you, you know? Like you can't just learn a language by like reading something on your Duolingo. You have to like go out and have a conversation. So staying focused and actively engaged, I wish I had done more of.
I have answered this question before, and I always say, I think there's a lot of pressure when you're younger and when you're older to be just like everyone else. And even when you're an adult and you think like, oh, I don't need to be just like this person that I'm seeing on Instagram. I don't have to have the same life. I don't need to do that. I'm not supposed to. You still feel like you should. You know, like, you still feel like you should be going to a fancy party when all your friends are at a fancy party or something, even if you don't like it. I think that knowing what makes you different and, like, embracing and emphasizing that can be really powerful and can actually get you further. I feel like there are so many weird things about me that are actually so cool, and if I had just, like, put all my energy into like embracing those things and working with them rather than like trying to suppress them so I could just be like everyone else in Racine, Wisconsin, then I would be further ahead than I am now. You know, just be your, let your freak flag fly.
Okay, well, I think that's about all we have time for, but I just wanted to thank fans for giving us this platform and this opportunity to get together and talk about real human intellectual things, and for, you know, giving us a platform to talk about, like, the strength that we have and style and expression and all that, but, and thank you guys for all coming out to support us, and Katie Cash is going to be DJing up next.